Good morning. Thank you so much for joining us this morning. This is Harvest Conference, the Focus Edition. I'm so glad to be here this morning to take you through today's morning devotion. My name is Wangashi Mwaniki. Right before we get into it, take a moment, bow your head, let's pray. Our Father and our God, we are so grateful that you've allowed us to be here. You've allowed us to share, and you've allowed us to commune even through the interwebs. We pray that God, even as we go through scripture, you will open our ears, open our hearts to receive it. Help us to also put it into action. We thank you and we honor you, for it's in Jesus' name we have prayed, believing and trusting. Amen. Today I want us to focus on Jesus as our high priest. So I want us to look at this attribute of Jesus, him being our high priest. I'm going to read Hebrews chapter 9 from verse 11 to 15. I'm going to read from the English Standard Version. But when Christ appeared as a high priest of the good things that have come, then through the greater and more perfect tent, not made with hands, that is, not of this creation, he entered once for all into the holy places, not by means of the blood of goats and calves, but by means of his own blood, thus securing an eternal redemption. For if the blood of goats and bulls and the sprinkling of defiled persons with the ashes of a heifer sanctify for the purification of the flesh, how much more will the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without blemish to God, purify our conscience from dead works to serve the living God? Therefore, he is the mediator of a new covenant, so that those who are called by many receive the promised eternal inheritance, since a death has occurred that redeems them from the transgressions committed under the first covenant. I love the book of Hebrews because if you're looking to understand who Jesus is, that's where you go. Basically, the book of Hebrews says Jesus is the Son of God. Jesus is greater than the angels. Jesus is a high priest. Jesus is a king. Jesus is. If you're looking to understand all the attributes of Christ, Hebrews is a place to go. And in chapter 7, 8, and 9, we focus on this great attribute of Christ, which is him being a high priest. Now, in the Old Covenant, which is the covenant of the children of Israel, through the Torah, through the law, they had priests. Why? When we sinned and when we fell away from God's grace, really, we couldn't be able to commune and access God because he's holy. And at that moment, when we sinned, we couldn't be holy. So Christ, God made a way for us to be able to commune with him, but not getting too close so that we are not burnt off because of this holiness, but not being too far away so that we are not experiencing his love. And one of the ways that God did this is by having the tribe of Levi from Israel become priests so that they could minister and become these gatekeepers and mediators between the children of Israel and God. And so the priests would get into this tent that was, you know, made so that they could go and offer burnt offerings for the children of Israel. And so the priests would go inside, would access this tent, and they'd go and make sacrifices on behalf of Israel so that they could be atoned for. What is atonement? It's when someone gives themselves up for your sins. So what was in place for, because when we sin, really, we just fall. It's missing the mark. Sin is missing the mark, and we fall from grace. So how do you have people who have fallen from grace able to access God? They have to die, because the wages of sin is death. So in place of you dying, the Israelites would have this lamb, this lamb that was supposed to have no blemish, was supposed to be clean, was supposed to act as an atonement for their sins. And so the priests would go up and offer a sacrifice for themselves first, because they were human and they were also weak and they sinned, and then for the people, so that God could hear them and God could have communion with them. And so the problem with the Old Covenant, or this problem that arises with that covenant, is there's no amount of offering that could make the Israelites clean. It was an imperfect covenant because people are imperfect. There's no amount of offerings, there's no amount of awesome priests that could make the Israelites righteous or pure. And so these people still could not be perfected. Still, there was still a way they could not commune with God. There was still a level they could not get to. But now, because of the new covenant, now because of Christ. Because Christ is the Lamb. He acts as our atonement. And the reason he's this great Lamb is because he is perfect. He's not like sheep and cows. He's not like those old priests who had to die because they were also imperfect. This high priest, Christ Jesus, our high priest, is perfect. He acts as the Lamb, and through him we are atoned for. He acts as this high priest whose priesthood does not end. Because remember, the old priests, they had to die. They'd die of old age and disease and other things. And so another priest would come and take over. But Christ, our high priest, has died, has resurrected, and is seated at the right hand of God. So he does not, he's not going to die again. So this priesthood has no end. This high priest, on top of being perfect and dying for our sins so that we're atoned for, him also living forever, he deserves all the glory because he was God made man for our sins. And so he has initiated us into a better covenant where we can go to him and we have full access to the throne of God. And this is the part where I invite you to look at Jesus as this great, great, great mediator, because he is. Through Christ, now we have access to God. Through Christ, now we can go to God for ourselves. We're not like the children of Israel who had to rely on someone else to go and take their problems first. No, we are in a better covenant that wherever we are, we can go to God and he hears us and he listens to us. We can worship God with this liberty of wherever you are, really. You can kneel on your floor and just go to God and he hears. The book of Hebrews chapter 7, chapter 8, and chapter 9 really shows us how Christ giving himself as this great sacrifice stamps him as this great high priest whose priesthood does not end. Other people bring this question of, but Christ was not from the tribe of Levi, so how is he a priest and the Levites are the ones who are the priests? But the writer of Hebrews gives us this beautiful, beautiful analogy of Melchizedek. Melchizedek was this king of Salem who Abraham gave a tenth to, a tithe really, to, even before the whole notion of tithing came about. And Melchizedek was called a priest of God, even though the whole Levite thing had not appeared. And why Christ is being compared to this genealogy of Melchizedek is because Melchizedek has no genealogy as per the Bible. We don't see his mother, we don't see his father. He's a reigning priest and king who has no beginning and has no end. And that is the same with Christ. He is a king, he is a priest with no beginning and no end. And so we can be assured that whatever we take to him, it's forever. Yani, this is a better covenant. Yani, now we are able to access God in a way that we couldn't before. And why am I speaking about Christ as our high priest in this season and in this time when we're having Harvest Corn Focus Edition? When you pause and look at Christ as a high priest and understand that he has taken your transgressions on himself, has gotten he has given himself as a sacrifice, he's also taken it upon himself to take all your problems to God, you're able to be living a free life. There is freedom in that. You're able to live a fulfilling life because now you realize there's no these barriers and motaratara as you go to God. He's not looking at you as this horrible person who is so far away and can't access him. But now because of Jesus and because of what Christ has done, God is looking at you through the eyes of Christ. He's looking at you and seeing Jesus. Is looking at you and seeing the righteousness of Christ, and you're able to have communion. Come on, somebody. You're able to have communion with God. And it's such a place of pause, ponder, seller, breathe, to know that God hears me, God understands me, God gets what I'm going through, and through Christ, I am atoned for. Through Christ, I am redeemed. Through Christ, I am made whole. Through Christ, I am made righteous. What calves and lambs and goats could not clean, Christ, because he's the great Lamb, has cleaned. What blood of the blood of lambs, what they could not do, what the purity that they could not bring, Christ has brought, because he's a greater mediator, a greater high priest. And so I challenge you this morning to first of all read Hebrews chapter 7, chapter 8 and chapter 9. I also challenge you to pause and go to God and ask him, help me to see Jesus as my high priest. Help me to see Jesus as this great sacrifice that now I have full access to you because of him. And when you look at Jesus, when you focus your eyes on him and see him as this great mediator, there is liberty, there is freedom. I want us to pray. And I'm going to be praying for every one of you because I am believing you're watching this in faith, that God would give you understanding and would open the eyes of your understanding, really, to be able to understand the great sacrifice that Christ has done and to be able to understand what it means for you now as a believer, now as a Christian, that Christ is your high priest and his kingdom lives forever. Another thing that's very interesting, the old priests, they would never sit down really because their work was never done. But Christ is seated at the right hand of God to signify, to show us, it's a signal that the work is done. When he died on Calvary and rose again, the work is done. He's not offering himself up again. He's not coming back to offer up himself again. In fact, Hebrews 9 concludes by saying he's coming for a victorious church. He's coming for a victorious people because the work is done. So I want to pray for you that God would open the eyes of your understanding and you'd see the significance of Christ being your high priest and you'd see the liberty and the freedom that you are able to walk in now as a child of God with this knowledge that Christ is your mediator, Christ is your high priest, and you have full access to God because of Christ. Let's pray. Our God and our Father, we are so grateful because you've allowed us to go through this simple, just portion of scripture and just to get to know you and realize that we have full access to you because of Christ. We pray that God, you'd allow us and you'd allow the people watching, the people listening in this morning and even later to realize that because of Christ, we now have liberty and freedom to worship you, O God. Because of Christ, we have freedom and liberty to worship you and to live for you and to offer up ourselves as living sacrifices. Because of Christ, you are calling us righteous. Because of Christ, when he comes back for his church, we will be made one with you because of Christ. We ask that, Lord, even as we live our lives, even as we try to just do our best, even as we honor you with our lives, O God, that you'd allow us to continue being changed by this fact that Christ is our great mediator, that Christ is our high priest, that Christ, when we look to him, we live. We look and live, and we are so grateful. We pray that God, you'd continue to keep us well, that you'd continue to allow us to just grow in your word, to grow in prayer, to continue to fall in love with you, oh God, even in this season and many seasons to come. We love you and we honor you this morning. Be praised, be exalted. In Jesus' name we have prayed, believing and trusting. Amen. Thank you for joining us today. Have a beautiful day and keep on Harvest Conference 2020, the Focus Edition.